Hey everybody, my name is Geneva of Geneva's Closett Talk Show. And what is Geneva's Closett Talk Show? Well, it is the hottest talk show around. I'm just keeping it real, people. Mm-hmm, yes, I am. Today's show is going to be really good. It's perfect for music artists, producers, beat makers, or just overall anybody in the music industry. And why is that? Because today's special guest is super music producer, Grammy nominated producer. Who is that? His name is James Worthy, not to be mistaken with the basketball player. I said Grammy nominated and super producer James Worthy. He was here before, probably about a year ago, but he is back in Geneva's Closet. So you stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with James Worthy in Geneva's Closet.
What's up, y'all? This is James Worthy, super producer, and I am sitting here in Geneva's Closet.
Hey everybody, I am back. It's me again, Geneva of Geneva's Closet, and I'm sitting here with who I told you I was going to be here with, super music producer, Grammy nominated producer, not to be mistaken with the basketball player. I'm talking about James Worthy. How you doing today, James?
I'm awesome. Blessed.
Yes, and you know what? I just want to start off, because every time I got an interview, I always have to start off with some stuff. Well, first of all, James was with me. He was in Geneva's Closet about a year ago, but we back and we better today, ain't we, James?
We back better
today. Yes. But I wanted to say that I have been watching you since you were on Geneva's Closet the last time, and what I can say is, James, you out there working hard, man. You out there getting it in.
The grind is real. The grind is real.
Yes, I mean, like, every time I look at you, people, you got to go check out his Instagram page at King James Worthy, because every time you look on there, James, you either taking some pictures with some celebrities, you're doing some type of work, you're being featured in magazines. I mean, you're doing things with, you know, I don't know if you host or if you judge artists, events, or things like that, but you're constantly busy. James, how are you able to stay relevant?
Man, well, I always say it's a different time now than years before, especially with social media now. So yeah. I try to take all platforms as much as I can. So like you said, from working on different projects, whether it's television, film, movies, of course, music. I have my own production company where I have producers and songwriters that are assigned to me exclusively, so I have that, and man, just 24/7, so you know, you're gonna catch me doing a lot of stuff.
Yes, you just getting it, people. He is just getting it. All James, that. Look, can you tell us about this production company? Don't we want to know about that, people?
Yeah, well, basically it's called King's Vision Music Group, and like I said, it's a production company where I sign producers and songwriters for me to work with them exclusively on different projects that I got going on. So whether me collaborating with them on production or having them write on certain records along with me, you know, it's kind of that thing.
Okay, so are you currently looking for people or do you already have your people?
Right now, we're not really signing at the moment, but okay, we are always collaborating with other people outside of the company. So if you got something dope, man, that we can use, you know, we always down for that.
People, now you heard what he said. Okay, so you don't just work with celebrities, you work with indie artists or people, you know, up and coming artists.
Definitely.
What? A producer like you, James, Grammy nominated super producer? We got to find out about a little bit how he got his music start. James, for the people who don't know, how did you get your start in the whole music industry thing?
How did I get my start? Well, I'm from New York. So I really don't come from a big musical background, but with the exception of my father, he used to play drums and percussion, you know, back in the day, and he wasn't really too heavy in it, but he taught some stuff to me. And as I got older, I grew a love for music a lot more. And by me doing that, I tried to figure out what my calling was, and I started really researching producers and musicians and songwriters. I'm like, okay, I really like how this sounds. I want to know how they made that to sound like that.
Okay.
So I'm like, okay, let me research that. And one of the actual big pivotal points was me actually getting to see Michael Jackson in person for the first time. And this was like, I had to be like 10 or 11 years old. And that right there was like a game changer for me.
I'm like, sound like it to me.
You know, there wasn't, there's not a lot of people that you could say they saw Michael Jackson up front and personal like that. So that really kind of changed a lot for me, man.
Okay.
And, after that, I started really, not really chasing industry people, but just trying to get my face in front of industry people to let them know that I was really serious about it. And after that, man, it was straightforward.
Okay, so you said that you're from New York, but you're in Atlanta now, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so did you feel like that it was needed for you to move to Atlanta? So do you feel like for the music artists out there that there's a bigger opportunity as far as trying to get in the music industry in Atlanta?
I mean, Atlanta is a music hub right now. You know, we're not even really for music, it's entertainment, really.
It is.
TV and film and all kind of stuff out there. But if you really want to make, let me see, because it's hard to say sometimes, because you got New York, you got LA, you have different cities who are known for different things, but Atlanta is definitely one of the melting pots right now because there's so many people that moved to Atlanta.
Okay.
So I would say if you're trying to make a statement right now and trying to network and build your resume, Atlanta would be one of the places you definitely have to be.
Okay. So is that why you moved to Atlanta? Because you felt like that it would be better for your career?
Definitely. I mean, okay, when I came, it was a little bit different. You know, it was early 2000s. So, you know, times were a little bit different. The economy was different. The industry business model was a little different. But, you know, to say that, you know, things were, let me see, because a lot of my clients were in Atlanta at the time. And
okay,
of course, coming from New York, you know, Atlanta is a lot cheaper.
I heard.
You know, that'll definitely do it to you. But, you know, it was just one of those things where I just had to make a move for what I thought was best, and, you know, it worked out.
Okay, now, for the people who don't know, now, I only have some of the names written down because James, literally, it's a whole list of people that he's worked with. But I'm just going to throw out a few names, people, okay? James may want to tell you the others. But I have T-Pain, Young Bird, Pitty Pablo, Sara Stokes, Bobby Brown Jr., Men at Large, B&GB, just recently, Supa Peach. I was like, what? Supa Peach too? And then, like, I have on my list, correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Dre. James, can you please tell us about the Dr. Dre situation? Don't we want
to
know?
Oh, man, shout out to Aftermath, shout out to Dre and all of them, man. Dre is a cool guy. I had a chance to meet with him and work on a record with him in L.A., couple years back, and it was just an awesome experience. Wow. You know, Dre, he's very secretive on what he's working on.
So okay.
Project, but you know, I was just, you know, blessed and fortunate to have that time to work with him. And shout out to Truth Hurst too, man. Truth Hurst, was, if you guys don't know who Truth Hurst is, she was his artist early 2000s on Aftermath.
Oh, okay, okay.
And, you know, y'all know her record, Addictive, with Rakim, and a huge record.
Yes, so, we know, yes.
So shout out to them.
Yes, shout out. James, what I want to ask you, because I remember you just saying that something that you did was you were trying to get your face in front of the people, or was it celebrities or just people that you felt like it was important for you to be in front of so they can notice you?
I mean, it didn't really have to be celebrities, just, you know, industry professionals, you know, whether it was A&Rs or executives or people who I thought can give an opportunity, you know.
So it's all about networking then. Absolutely. See, the reason why I'm asking some of these questions is because there will definitely be producers, people trying to rap and do music watching this interview. And to be perfectly honest with you, James, you are the expert. You are out there doing the thing, working hard, and people want to know from you, like, how often do you have the chance to talk to a super music producer that's Grammy nominated? So, you know, people just kind of want to know from you, like, how do you get your face in front of these people? Is it about networking?
It's a number of things. I mean, networking is very important. You know? If you don't have a network, then you don't have a net worth. You know what I mean? So you have to know certain people. You have to know how to maneuver any industry because things are different now. So, you know, and especially from the earlier days, everything was more so word of mouth. It was more so hand-in-hand contact. Now it's social media or email. You know what I mean? So you just have to know how to figure out ways that's going to work for you versus somebody else, because there's a lot of people that I notice who try to take other blueprints from someone else, and everybody's blueprint isn't going to work for everybody. You know what I mean? So you have to figure out what works best for you, figure out your social media platforms, what's going to be your strategic plan to gain notoriety and attention, but in the right way. Finding what your brand is one point, but finding who your identity is through social media platforms is different too, because, you know, sometimes people put on this facade that there's something that they're not, or they're bigger than what they want to be, or whatever the case may be. But, you know, you just got to know how to move and study the game, study what people are doing, study, you know, take inspiration from what's already been done and make it your own.
Yes, James told you, the expert just told you how it's supposed to go. James, how did you get that Grammy nomination?
Grammy Academy. It was really unexpected. I tell this story all the time, man. I was actually sitting in Red Lobster one night with my assistant, and we were just going over some stuff and different ideas, and I just got a random call from the Grammy Academy, and this at the first call, the first initial call, it really wasn't telling me that I got anything. They were just kind of telling me, "Hey, you're sort of on the radar right now for a record that I didn't even expect to be even in the running."
Okay.
So I'm like, okay, that's pretty interesting. So a week goes by, and I get another call from them, and they told me, "Hey, you know, you got on the Grammy ballot." I'm like, "Wow,
wow!"
And that's how it went. It was pretty simple. It was pretty simple, but it was very shocking.
Wow. Okay. So, did you get like a certificate with your name on it saying Grammy nomination? I mean, so what do you get for that? Do you get something?
Well, when you're nominated, I mean, they don't really give certificates when you're nominated, actually win the award.
Okay.
But, you know, and just to let whoever's going to be watching this interview, just to let you guys know, everything is political nowadays.
Okay.
So when you see people winning Grammys, a lot of times they don't have the actual trophy unless you buy the trophy.
Get out of here. Get yourself. What?
Yeah, that's a misconception. So I'm not gonna put out the number of how much it costs because it's ridiculous.
Wow.
Yeah, you do have to buy the actual trophy.
James is giving some secrets right now. He's dropping some secrets on us that we had no idea about. Okay, so what song was that you got the Grammy nomination for?
It was actually for an artist by the name of Trevor Wesley that I was working with out in the UK.
Oh, wow. Okay. Wow.
So you got a nice fan base out there. I think the record was in the best contemporary pop category.
Oh, okay. Okay. So now, you know, because that was something that I was going to ask you. So you kind of work with artists in different genres of music. So it's not just R&B or hip hop.
Definitely. Definitely.
Oh, wow. So that's amazing. So you can be in contemporary pop, whatever, and then you're willing to work with them. So that means that you really got a good ear then, I'm assuming, for different types of music then.
Absolutely. I mean, I love all genres. So, you know, my mind is very worldly. You know, I travel the world. I do a lot of different things musically. So, you know, it's hard for me to stay closed and boxed in, you know, like I like to try different things and infuse different genres together, and you know, that's by the grace of God. You know, I've had blessings to work with certain artists in all different types of countries to, you know, just come together and make a masterpiece, man. You know, music has no boundaries.
Yes, go ahead. So what are some of the songs that you've produced, James?
Songs that I've produced,
or, you know, people that you've worked with that I didn't mention, or that you want to extra throw out because you got some other stuff you want to say about that?
Ah, From what you've already put out there, who else can I add in there?
Come on. I know it's a long list.
Love Robin S. You can add in Johnny Blaze. You probably know her from Love and Hip Hop.
Yes.
Natasha Mosley. You can add in Kehlani. You can add in, who else we got? Jessica Dime, Love and Hip Hop.
Okay.
Who else do we have? Dreezy. Who else? Man, there's so many of them, man. My mind goes blank all the time.
Did you work with Jay-Z?
No, I haven't had a chance to work with Jay-Z yet.
Okay. Okay. So that takes me to my next question. What's some of the artists that you would like to work with?
That I would like to work with.
Yes.
Definitely Kanye West.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely Frank Ocean.
Okay.
Chris.
Oh, Brown. I love Frank.
Erykah Badu.
Mm-hmm.
Sia. Maroon 5.
Okay.
There's tons of them.
Now, since you've been producing music, has there ever, you know, because I know you've met some extraordinary people. Because I know first you were starstruck with Michael, but since you've been producing, have you ever came across an artist and you was just like starstruck, like, I can't believe I'm standing here in the presence of this artist? James, like, to who, me? Not me.
Well, to be honest, the only person that was really starstruck was Michael. That was really the only person, because that's like the ultimate to me.
Yes, I can understand.
You know, I see everybody is a regular person, you know what I mean? Like, and a lot of people even tell me, to my point, you know, do you know who you are? Do you, you know, you did this, you did that? Like,
no.
And you know what? Like, I'm just more so, I'm a humble spirited person. Like, I don't even see myself as a celebrity as they call me, but I don't really see myself like that because I'm just a regular person in my eyes. But, you know, I just see everybody as who they should be. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So we all have the same thing. We all do the same thing. We're all trying to make masterpieces and get to the next level.
Yeah. But you're just out there hustling super hard, James. I mean, like, you really are. The things that you've accomplished in this year's time, like I said, it's just extraordinary. Me watching you, I mean, like, he really out there doing his thing, just out there. Just interview after interview. Like, don't you ever get tired, James? Okay. Be like, I need to go sit down. So, I don't want to do no more interviews. I'm not producing today. I'm just going to go sit down. Do you ever get tired?
It takes a toll on me sometimes. You know, sometimes I got to back it down and kind of take some time to myself. But still, at the end of the day, you know, it's a business, man. And,
and
it's a million people trying to take your spot. So, you got to keep the consistency and keep grinding and working hard, man. You know, that's
true. Now, besides the people that you said that you're working with your production company, are there any other artists or celebs that you're working with?
Yeah, well, right now, I'm working on Johnny Blaze's new album.
Okay.
So we are working on that project, working on Tony Sunshine, Terrence Hart, Bone Crusher.
Bone Crusher coming back out?
Yeah, Bone, he working, he won't.
Okay.
What else we got? So many projects, man. Arrested Development project. Who else do we have? Tony Terry.
No, you working with Tony? Is you working with Tony? What? We love Tony. Throwback. We love Tony. Okay. Tony, get it in, James. Get it in.
Good, man. Who else we got, man? Actually, this is really interesting. Angel McCartney, who's a WNBA superstar player. She plays for Atlanta Dream.
Okay.
She's actually an artist as well, so I'm actually working on her album.
What? This man is just working with everybody, doing every type of thing. Go ahead, James.
We open up boundaries, man. I'm even working with Sydney Starr, the transgender reality star.
Really?
Yeah, a lot of people know her for, you know, her social media.
Yes, I've seen it, yes.
With the whole chingy situation.
Yes.
but yeah, man, she's an artist as well, so I'm working on her project. Man, there's just so many things going on. And also, too, got some movies that I'm in, some television shows, working on my new book. So, yeah, man.
You're writing a book, too, James. Yeah, you busy for real, for real. I mean, like, for real, FRFR. This man is seriously busy. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, because it's just too much, people. I had stuff written down, but he throwing out extra stuff. Can you tell us about the acting and the modeling? We need to know about these things.
Okay, as far as the acting, I'm in a new movie called Love by Chance, which has myself in it, has Terry Vaughn, Clifton Powell, Little Zane. And I'm also working on Lil Zane's album too, so that's
okay.
But yeah, man, it's like a romantic comedy film. So you'll see me in a very dope scene with Clifton Powell. So it's gonna be hot.
Okay.
I believe it's supposed to be dropping either April or Mayish.
Okay, we're gonna be looking out.
Once those details drop, I'll definitely let you guys know.
How did you get into acting, first of all, James? Like, how did you go from producing music and now you're acting? How is that?
Well, I'm a very artistic person. You know, I love creativity. So any way that I can release any expression that I have built up, you know, creative-wise, I like to put it in those formats. And acting was just one of those things I wanted to try out, man. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they told me I was a natural, so it's all good.
Okay, go ahead and do your thing, James. Go ahead and do it. Yeah, okay, so tell us about the modeling.
As far as the modeling, I haven't been doing a lot of modeling lately because I've been so wrapped up in the other projects, but that's something that I'm going to delve into more so later this year.
Okay.
But yeah, television and film is what I've been really focusing on. Of course, music as well.
And then he was also featured, for those of you who didn't know, on Centrix From the Bottom Up. That's because of him producing Sara Stokes, doing some work with Sara Stokes. And he's been on TMZ. Just in case you didn't know that. And during this interview, I'm probably going to try to slide a little snippet of that in there so you can see him on TMZ, because I think I do got some of that information.
James Worthy, just want to give my comments on Straight Outta Compton. You know, first off, I think it was just kind of, I would say, an insult to the actors and people involved in the movie.
Man, shout out to everybody. Shout out to BET, Centric, Sarah, Nikki Gilbert, the whole cast. It was a dope experience. I'll be on a new television series in March called Less, which is going to be airing on Fox.
On Fox? Now this man is coming on Fox. Okay.
Yeah, man. So I'll be on my, you'll see me on my Lucius line.
Okay. Get it in, James. Get it in. So I'm assuming that you love acting now, that acting is your new other thing.
Yeah, man. I mean, you know, the cool thing about it is, all of the features I've been doing on mainstream television is all music based.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So it's not taken away from the essence of what I'm doing. I'm putting everything together, acting wise and music wise together, you know? So that was the focus that I really wanted to pinpoint.
Okay. And,
you know, going forward, you know, I'll be taking more deeper roles and things like that in other films, but yeah, man, we working.
Yes, you sure are. So based on the things that you're saying and based on some of the things that I see that you're doing, I'm assuming that you feel like that if you're going to do this thing and you're going to try to put yourself out there, that you need to try to see, you know, all aspects of different things. If you feel like that you're good at it, then maybe you should just give it a try and see if you are, and not be scared, not just keep it at one thing. Would you say that, James?
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, you can't be scared. You know, you got to be fearless, and you got to have a strong mind to be in this business. You know, there's a lot of naysayers, a lot of people who, you know, want to take you off the right path and say that you can't do certain things, or you're not good enough, or you know, someone else is better than you. You know, we all have greatness in us, you know, which is why I have my own hashtag, Humble Greatness, because we all have some type of greatness in us, and it's up to us to bring it out. You know what I mean? But in order to bring it out, you have to humble yourself, and you have to know that, okay, this is what I want to do. Nobody's going to stop me from doing it. And that's it. The key to success. It's, you know what, it's Well, it's not even really for producers. It's really for everybody in the music industry. But producers, the key thing is to be consistent. You know what I mean? So, you know, I've noticed a lot through the years, especially 2015, 2016. You know, everything nowadays is all about fads and what's popular at the time and what's going to bring you popularity right now. But a lot of people don't open themselves up to look at the bigger picture to continue being relevant. You know what I mean? Because if you have a hot song, you know, a lot of people don't even notice, but the lifespan of a song is 3 to 6 months.
So
the lifespan of a typical song.
Okay.
Only because people's attention spans are so short.
Wow.
So they want to hear something hot right now. They're like, okay, that's getting old. What else you got? What else you got? You know, it's not like before, early years where you had a whole body of work. People just sat down with that album and they just listened to the album for like a year.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean? And live with that. You know, like, that's why people are constantly dropping singles all the time, or they're dropping EP after EP or album after album, because, you know, you got to be consistent. So same thing with producers. You know, it's hard to, I think now it's even harder than ever to place records, because, you know, you have labels now who have set list of producers, and you got artists who have in-house producers now, and they have their own teams, and you know, so it's kind of hard to get in those camps. You know what I mean? So you really have to figure out what the game plan is going to be out the gate. So my thing is, break your own artist. You know, make sure you produce an artist that you know you think can blow, has potential, and move from there.
Now I'm just going to throw something about my little thing on how I perceive things, because I'm not huge in the music industry, because I'm no James, okay, people? I'm no James. But when I do hear an artist's music, I feel like, especially today's time, it needs to be tagged with a video. So do you feel like that when artists make songs, it's imperative that they get a video with that too? Or what would you say about that?
Definitely. I mean, visuals are very important.
Mm-hmm.
We live in a visual world now. Everybody wants to see versus hear. You know what I mean?
Okay. But
music videos are very important. I mean, even going past music videos, you want to, you know, and this goes into actually like social media consulting too, which I do as well.
Okay.
I see a lot of times too, when people are promoting their music, they don't really know how to promote it the right way. So, you know, you need to have promotional videos, you know, snippets of the actual music videos to lead up to the anticipation of your official video. You need audio snippets of your music, you know what I mean? Because and even though that's not really a visual, it's still in a video format.
Yeah.
So people's eyes are drawn to video.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, man. I mean, webisodes, you know what I mean?
Okay.
Day in a life showing what an artist goes through.
Oh, wow. That too? Okay.
You know what I mean? And showing your creative process in the studio. Just letting people in. You know, people want to see how you create your magic.
That's true too. Yeah, I like that too. Letting them in so then you can feel like you getting to know the person and seeing the things that they're going through. Yeah, I actually think that that's a really good idea. Now, James, I'm not going to have you on here for too much longer because I know you're a busy man. But I just heard somebody mention something. Okay, and I'm basing this off of what you just said, that the lifespan of a song is usually, you said, like 3 months. That sounded a little scary to me. That's like, I just put the dang on song out there. Now I got to have another one out. So, because I heard somebody, a music artist, mention that he was doing an EP. Mm-hmm. And I asked him why, and he said that he felt that was better because people, like you said, attention spans are a little small, so he didn't feel like he should do anything bigger than that. What do you have to say about that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we all know that physical albums aren't selling like that anymore. So everything is really digital and streaming. Then again, an EP is pretty much a pre-album. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So 5 to 7 songs on the EP. And it's really just a way to, one, give less music, but it's a different way to also release more singles.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a prelude to drop your official album. But
okay.
In order to drop an official album, you need to have, you just need to have loyal fans that are into your brand to actually buy the official album. You know, because
okay.
An album is supposed to be like the shebang.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, this is my album. Like, this is what represents me, you know, as a true artist.
Okay.
And EP can do the same thing, you know, because there's artists that travel the world just off of EPs.
Mm.
You know, but
wow.
You know, we're in a different time. You know, EPs are mostly free projects, but okay. Artists sell EPs as well. But, you know, right now, I think EPs are the best way to go because albums aren't really selling that much right now.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you have a great following.
How many songs should be on the EP or the mixtape? How many do you recommend?
Oh, for an EP, it's from 5 to 7.
Okay. And what about a mixtape?
Mixtape, it really doesn't matter for a mixtape. You know, mm-hmm. All the way up to 20 songs on a mixtape.
Oh, okay. I didn't know all that.
Really,
people get it in like that on the mixtape, about 20 of them? Okay.
A mixtape is a free-for-all. So, you know, you have leeway to do whatever you want to do on a mixtape. An EP, it's a little bit different. You know, it's a little more structured, like an album would be,
mm-hmm.
In a smaller format.
Okay. Now, James, I feel like this is a very important question for you. People are always saying, or you know what, because I see this all the time, just on Unsung alone, people feeling like they're getting played in the music industry when it comes to the business side. But right. Since you've been that, done that already, what's some advice you can give to some of these music artists about the business side of the music industry that they need to be aware of?
Boy, that's a lot right there.
Oh, really? Is it that much?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's you got to make sure your contracts are right. You got to mm-hmm. make sure that you're dealing with the right people, you know, because you have a lot of snakes out here. You know,
okay.
This is a music business. You know, it's a business. So you have people who are trying to make some type of profit.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make sure of, you have to be aware of what you're signing, you know, because you have labels nowadays or companies who try to get over on you, you know, they try to throw numbers at you, you know, try to make everything seem like it's all good. And,
okay.
You know, like you said, I've been there, done that, you know, mm-hmm. I still know my ups and downs, but, you know, you just have to be smart about it, learn from your mistakes, have great people around you, great energy, and keep it moving. So, you know, for producers, you know, make sure you got your split sheets right. Make sure that, you know, you get your credits on all paperwork that you sign. Make sure that you're not signing your publishing away, you know, and my advice would be, you know, to stay the indie route. If you are signing with a major label, you know, just do some type of co-publishing deal with a label or, you know, just try to keep as much, ownership as possible.
Okay. Wow. Thank you so much, James, for that information. And I really do mean thank you so much for that information because you really are the expert. You know, because everybody else, all the other music artists that I've had in here so far are trying to get to your level. You know, like they want to rub elbows with some celebrities and produce some stuff and get some Grammy nominations. They would like to, you know, but you're already there. So whatever you have to say about it, your word is bond with this thing. Like they need to hear what you have to say. So I really do appreciate you taking your time out of your day to come and speak to Geneva and Geneva's Closett. And I also want to say to James, I'm just really proud of you for doing your thing. Like, I know that we ain't just hanging out, getting a drink and stuff, but just watching you on social media, I'm like, he's really doing this thing. So to see a black man out there getting his hustle on, go ahead, James. Go.
Yeah, man, we got to do it, man. It's 2017, man.
Yes.
It's so hard to go home.
Yes. Okay, so where do you see yourself? This is my last question, uh-huh. Besides your social media information. Where do you see yourself in like a year or two from now? Since you're already doing wonderful things.
A year or two from now, of course, releasing new music, bigger TV and film roles.
Yes.
You'll see, of course, my first book will be released, so you'll be seeing part 2 and part 3.
Okay. And what is the book going to be about?
Oh, well, the name of the book is called Music Nostalgia.
Okay.
And basically, it's a autobiography of me and my journey, slash a producer's and songwriter's manual. So pretty much everything we discuss on this interview more will be in that book, and just kind of giving my testimony and my story, man, and you know, inspiring people to do what they love to do, man, and letting them know what really goes on as being a producer and a songwriter.
Wow, I can't wait to I can't wait for that book to come out, because I can't wait to tell everybody, all the music artists, make sure you go check out James' book, because you're gonna need that, people. You're gonna need that. You know, something to help you figure out what you should be doing, right, James?
Yeah, man. I mean, it's you know, and the whole premise of the book is it's basically for it to be a study guide for new musicians, songwriters, producers, and all of that. Because, you know, I notice a lot when I do a lot of panels, when I do a lot of consulting, you know, people listen and people love to come out and hear me speak about certain things. But, you know, you may not grasp everything when you're there. You know what I mean? So this is something that you can actually study, you can have, you can be like, hey, you know, maybe I heard him touch on this subject just a little bit
right
when I heard him talk, but you'll get the whole details in the book. You know what I mean? So yeah, you know, make sure you guys pick it up. It's coming out soon. So the details.
When is soon, James? When is it this year?
No, it's definitely this year.
Okay.
We're shooting for summer. So once we got all the details solidified and we got all the announcements ready, you'll be seeing it.
Well, make sure you tag me in it so I can make sure that I post it to Geneva's Closett page.
You know, I tag you in all kind of stuff, so it's all good.
Yes, he does, because we're here, people. We are here. James, where can everybody find you at? They want to find you.
I'm pretty simple. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at King James Worthy. You can find me on Facebook at King James Worthy Music. And even simpler than that, go to kingjamesworthy.com. And if you want to hit me directly for any type of business inquiries, just email me, jamesworthybookings@gmail.com. And yeah, just hit me.
And if you think he lying about the stuff that he's done, just Google him, boo-boo. Just
all there.
That's all you got to do. It's all up there. But once again, Jay, is it anything that you wanted to say? Because he's the expert. Let him say whatever he got to say. This is his interview.
All right. Well, you know what? Actually, I want everybody to be on the lookout for the brand new single from the Rude Boys and Men at Large. We have a brand new single that we are dropping next month entitled I Love You. It's a R&B, 90s R&B smash.
90s R&B? 90s?
It's an amazing record.
Okay.
Shout out to my producer, Ray Boy, as well. He's the one who assisted me on the track. So, yeah, man, we working.
Yes. And we love 90s music. Anything throwback. And he done brought it forward. We love it. Well, I know I do. James.
Oh, I'm R&B all the way.
Yes. Oh, my God. Yes, Lord. That's why you see how excited I got when you said Tony Terry. I almost fell. I almost passed out slightly. Not Tony.
That's my brother, man.
We're going to try to see. Maybe we can get Tony in Geneva's Closet. I don't know. I'm just throwing it out there.
But holla at him. Tony's super cool, man.
Yes. I would love to. Is there anything else you want to let the people know? Because he got so much, people.
That's it, man. Just stay tuned. Keep it locked on my social media, and you'll see everything.
Yes. Thank you so much again, James, for coming to speak to Geneva again.
I appreciate you.
In Geneva's Closet. This was fun. I hope I wasn't too animated for you, James. Oh, I can be like this.
This is awesome. It's like a conversation, you know.
That's how I want it to be, because we love James. So, yes, people, make sure you go check him out. All his information is there. And thank you again, James. You have a wonderful day.
Well, baby.
Bye.